Robin,
I hope you can see the Word file as well as you can see me. So today we are going to discuss about the nature of Maratha Confederation. Confederation is, I hope you understand, confederation is when different powers or different group, they come together with some interest. They have some common interest. For example, we have Confederation of Indian Industries. So the different industries group, they come together so that they can collectively do something that will benefit everyone. And they generally have their own power as well. They do have their own independent areas of function. That is what is called confederation. So Maratha, when we try to understand the Maratha administrative structure, it was not a centralized administrative structure like Mughals have put in the place in India. Like Mughals, the king used to be the sole power. He can transfer the governors. He can appoint the important officers. But in case of Maratha administrative structure, the central authority was not so powerful. Like the Shindes and Holkar and Bhosles of Nagpur, they established their area of domination into the different places. And the Chhatrapati or later on Peshwas did not had any power to transfer them from one area to another area. These people have created a kind of almost like an independent ruler they used to rule. So how this Maratha Confederation has evolved, how it used to function, that we will be discussing. And the significant portion of this also came in the discussion when we were discussing about the downfall of the Maratha Empire. But as it is mentioned as a separate topic, I will just quickly take an overview of the functioning of the Maratha Confederation. Maratha Confederation has grown gradually. During Chhatrapati Shivaji's time, it was not a kind of confederation, but it was more a central rule. Ashtapradhan Mandal, who used to be a kind of council who assisted Chhatrapati Shivaji in running the administration or giving him an advice. But all those Ashtapradhan, all those eight important ministers, they ruled till the time Chhatrapati Shivaji wanted them to be at the post. Otherwise, Chhatrapati Shivaji can dismiss them and appoint somebody else on their place. So the power was concentrated in the hands of the central authority, that is Chhatrapati. But what happened is, after Chhatrapati's death, Sambhaji became Chhatrapati. During his time also, the same central authority, it continued, because he reduced the power of other Ashtapradhan Mandal and he raised his own favorite Kavi Kalash by giving him title of Chandogomatya to the very high position. So till the time of Chhatrapati Sambhaji, that is 1689, this central rule continued. But after that, Rajaram comes to power, and during this transition period, that is Sambhaji's death, and during the time of Sambhaji also, Aurangzeb had invaded Maharashtra with a huge force. And after the killing of Sambhaji in 1689, large number of Maratha territory was conquered by the Mughal. And Rajaram, though he was made Chhatrapati by the Marathas, the capital fort, that is Raigad, was also attacked by the Mughal. And Swarajya, our own rule, as Chhatrapati Shivaji used to call it, had almost became extinct in Maharashtra. And we know that story further, that Rajaram has to run away from Maharashtra and take shelter at Jhansi. Now, Jhansi was also attacked by the Mughal. So the condition of Swarajya was almost quite precarious. It was about to become an extinct. Now, during this time, Rajaram has devised a method. I mean, he did not devise newly, but he reverted Saranjamshahi feudal system. He started giving Saranjam to the different Maratha Sardar. Saranjam means he gave them authority that you conquered this area and you will remain as a ruler to that area. You will collect the taxes, and part of the taxes you will pay to the central authority. So that system, which is generally called feudal system, and it remains more or less same with little variation in Europe as well as in India. So that feudal system was revived by Rajaram, and that was a need of the time, because now, in case if you don't give the Saranjam to the Maratha Sardar, and if you want to continue with the system that is put in the place by Chhatrapati Shivaji of giving a regular salary, there was no money left in treasury. And from where the money will come, because all the administrative structure has collapsed now because of the continuous war. And in case if you use saranjam, there will be a dual thing. You know, Marathas who were joining the service of the Aurangzeb in large number with the hope that they are being awarded saranjam by Aurangzeb. And now if they join Rajaram's army, they have this both thing. They are serving the Maratha cause, which was kind of emotional issue for the Marathas, and at the same time they got saranjam also. They got their own huge land on which they can pay tax, they can collect the taxes. So with this intention, Rajaram has revived this system of granting watan, granting saranjam, or granting zamindari. And it's because of this system that large number of Marathas, they are able to channelize their energy in conquering more and more areas. The area in Maharashtra, which was conquered by the Mughal, was reconquered by the Marathas, and that reconquered area had remained with them as a saranjam. And it is not only in Maharashtra now. Now they started, you know, as we have seen that Maratha War of Independence in the earlier semester, in the third semester, as the Mughals became more and more weak, the Marathas, they became more and more strong. And apart from Maharashtra, they also started attacking Mughal territory. And the arrangement, it continued to be remain same. If any Maratha Sardar conquers any Mughal territory, that territory will remain with that Maratha Sardar as his saranjam, as his watan, on which he was authorized to collect taxes and pay part of it to the central authority. So that is how this saranjam system, a kind of confederation, began to came into existence during the time of Rajaram, because of this peculiar political situation, and because of, you know, Rajaram himself was not personally a very brave, very active king. He died quite early at the age of 30. And after that, there was a civil war in Maharashtra. Like, one party supported Shahu, one party supported Tarabai, and Shahu has to lure away, attract many Sardar towards his side by promising them to give saranjam. So this Saranjamshahi system, that is a confederation system where the different Sardar had their own independent area under their control, and they just remain a kind of loosely connected different parts who came together for some specific purpose. During the period of Shahu also, the house of the Chhatrapati got divided into two parts. Satara, Shahu remained at Satara, and Tarabai's, that is, you know, Rajaram's descendant, they started ruling from Kolhapur. So within the confederation also, we find these two head. Of course, Shahu was by and large considered as the more prominent head of the Marathas, and large number of Marathas, they serve under Shahu. Now, as Shahu ruled for a very long period, and during Shahu's period, it was not the situation was not same as same as Rajaram. Rajaram was really hard pressed anyhow to ensure the survival of the Swarajya. But during Shahu's period, Mughals were become considerably weak, and there was no threat to the Maratha Empire as such. The empire had extended in all direction. But Shahu, from his part, did not try to do away with the Saranjamshahi system as Chhatrapati Shivaji has tried to do, and put the more centrally administrative structure which can endure for a long longer period, like Mughal administrative structure had endured for centuries together. He did not try, but he continued with the same saranjam system. And later on, as the power had passed into the hands of Peshwa had also did not try to do. They continue with the Saranjamshahi system, but try to control it. That is at the most they could do, but they did not innovate the system as the genius like Shivaji could do. And you know, one important person under Shahu who was instrumental in re-establishing the Saranjamshahi system was Balaji Vishwanath. He was not an expert military general, but he was a very clever diplomat. And he understood that if we try to impose the centrally administrative structure as done by Shivaji, probably the kingdom of Marathas will become extinct. And that is the reason why diplomatically he tried to win over a large number of Marathas to the side of Shahu by promising them jagir and by signing an agreement with them. Like, there is an example of Angre who ruled in Konkan, and there is an example of Bhosle of Nagpur. So all these people were brought in the Maratha Confederation with the intention that, with the promise that they will be given jagir, and obviously once you have a jagir, you rule virtually like an independent king. You have to just take a nominal order from the central authority, give certain taxes. So these different jagirdars at different places, they had their own army. And we now find that in the confederation, The power has also now shifted. Earlier, during Raja Ram's period and during the early phase of Shahu, it was Shahu who was considered as the head of this Maratha Confederation. But later on, Shahu, he was not very active. You know, he did not participate into the large number of war. And as a result, what happened is the power gradually passed into the in the hands of the Peshwa. And after the death of Shahu in 1749, next Chhatrapati was not at all capable. Neither he was respected by the Maratha nobility as Shahu was at least respected. So we find that the power gradually during the period of Shahu itself and after the period of Shahu more prominently passed into the hands of the Peshwa. Now, later on, we have already discussed this point. Later on, during the Barbhai's issue and Raghunath Rao murdering his own nephew and the first Anglo-Maratha war, the power has now again shifted from the hands of Peshwa to the hands of his Fadnis accountant, because Peshwa was a child and his Fadnis, Nana Fadnis, who did, you know, the post of Fadnis was not very important. He used to be just an accountant, and there used to be Fadnis with every Sardar who will look after the work of the account. But this Fadnis of Peshwa, he became almost like a head of the Maratha Confederation. Of course, his power was always contested by Mahadaji Shinde. We have studied this already. That in the Maratha Confederation during the latter phase, during the latter Peshwa's period, during the period of Savai Madhavrao, we have these two people who were leading the Maratha Confederation. Though Nana Fadnavis was looking after the administration from Peshwa's capital, that is Pune, Mahadaji Shinde did not allow him to interfere in his North Indian politics, which he managed on its own. So we find that this nature of confederation, it went on changing. During Rajaram's period, it came to it evolved as a political necessity for the survival of Swaraj. But Rajaram and Shahu during their lifetime continued to be the head. Shahu was at least respected. You know, no major expedition was carried out without informing him. And this practice was done away with after the death of Shahu. And Rajaram was a very nominal Chhatrapati. It was Peshwas who used to take the main important decision of this Maratha Confederation. So we find that power, the headship of the confederation shifting from Chhatrapati to Peshwa during the latter phase. So we find that as the power have now shifted from Chhatrapati to Peshwa and Peshwa to Fadanis, there was a considerable weakening of the central authority. Many Sardars of Chhatrapati were not willing to accept the headship of Peshwa, like Raghuji Bhosle of Nagpur. They believed that they are the servant of Chhatrapati and not the servant of Peshwa. And as a consequence, Peshwa has reacted in a different way. So instead of those old Sardars of Chhatrapati who were not willing to take orders from Peshwa, he brought forward his own Sardar like Sindes and Holkers and Pawar. So these were the Sardars who were brought forward by Peshwa Bajirao first. He gave them opportunity to establish their saranjam in northern India. And we find that Holkar establishing his saranjam, his almost like a kingdom at Indore, and Shinde at Gwalior, and Pawar at Dhar. So these people who were brought forward by Peshwas, though they knew that Chhatrapati is the actual head of the Maratha Confederation, they considered Peshwa as their head. Though nominally they did accept the overlordship of Chhatrapati, but their more loyalty, their immediate loyalty remained with Peshwa, whereas other many Maratha Sardar like Dabhade and Bhosle and Pratinidhi, they were not willing to accept Peshwa's overlordship, and as a result, there had been a lot of infighting among the these Maratha Sardar. Well, in 1719, Balaji Vishwanath, he brought Sanad from Delhi, and according to this Sanad, the Marathas, headed by Shahu, they got right to collect Chauth and Sardeshmukhi, two different taxes from the six provinces of South India. So now in the Maratha Confederation also, though Chhatrapati was the head of the Maratha Confederation, Chhatrapati himself has become vassal of the Mughal. And on the Mughal territory, Maratha used to attack. So and Chhatrapati Shahu was quite under the obligation of the Mughal, because he lived with Aurangzeb for a very long period, and it is believed that he promised to Aurangzeb that Marathas will not destroy the Mughal empire. So even though the Marathas, like ambitious Maratha like Bajirao Peshwa, wanted to expand and finally give a death blow to the tottering Mughal empire, Shahu used to restrain him. So in the Maratha Confederation also, it was not a singular motive that brought these people together. Though they had a kind of identity as a Maratha, and many of them understood that it is necessary that we should stick together in order to protect each other and in order to protect the Maratha Empire, which was started by a great Chhatrapati Shivaji. There was a lot of policy differences between the different segments of this Maratha Confederation. Well, Shahu, he did not, depending on the situation, he accepted Sanad because that has legitimized his position. But later on also, like when Mughal Empire became further weak, Shahu did not think it necessary to throw off this nominal Mughal sovereignty and declared himself independent like Shivaji has done. So that was one of the psychological conditioning of the period, that the Mughal Empire was treated as a kind of sacrosanct, and it is not to be done away with. And later on, it is Britishers who finally removed the Mughal Empire. Even though weak, the Marathas, they continue to maintain that house and continue to rule on the name of the Mughal Emperor. Even as late as 1790, when Mahadaji Shinde, he became Wakil-e-Mutalik. Wakil-e-Mutalik, the Farman of Wakil-e-Mutalik. Wakil-e-Mutalik means representative of the emperor, was given to Mahadaji Shinde, and Mahadaji Shinde did not accept it for himself, but he accepted it for the Peshwa. Savai Madhavrao Peshwa was too young. So Savai Madhavrao Peshwa remaining at Pune, Mahadaji Shinde was doing all the business of politics in the north, Savai Madhavrao becomes Wakil-e-Mutalik. So, there is a lot of complexities of that period, a lot of complication and intricacies of the political structure that was prevailing in the Maratha Confederation and their relation with the Mughal Emperor. Well, now Mughal Emperor, though nominal head of the Maratha, as Chhatrapati has accepted sovereignty of the Mughal Emperor himself has to depend on the protection of the Marathas. Because in return of that Sanad, in return of that Chauth, granting of Chauth and Sar Deshmukhi in the six provinces of southern India, Shahu was under obligation to protect the Maratha Empire with certain number of horses. Well, let me go ahead now. Well, now we see here in the Maratha Confederation, in the headship, Peshwa has increased his power and Chhatrapati now became less important. And same thing is later on followed by his own Sardar. As I already referred, Shindes and Holkar were the important Sardar brought forward by Peshwas himself. But as the Peshwas became weak later on after Madhavrao Peshwa, it was Shindes and Holkar who became a prominent, like Mahadaji Shinde became very prominent in the Maratha kingdom, and it was according to him that the main administrative policies were decided. So we see the power structure now getting divided into the two parts. From Pune, Nana Fadanvis started maintaining, managing, and northern Indian politics was mostly managed by Mahadaji Shinde. And later on, we find that we have already studied this during the second and third Anglo-Maratha War, how Bajirao Peshwa, in alliance with Daulat Rao Shinde, laid down the policies. He did not have any policies, but somehow he ruled. But Daulat Rao Shinde was having an important influence on the functioning of the Peshwa. So we see here the cycle is being repeated. Chhatrapati being sidelined by Peshwa, and Peshwa becoming supreme, and as the Peshwa decline after the fourth Peshwa, it is his own Sardar, the Peshwa Sardar, who were brought forward by him, becoming more prominent in the Maratha Confederation. And interestingly, in the Treaty of Salbai that was signed at the end of the fourth Anglo-Maratha War in 1782, Mahadaji Shinde took the responsibility of ensuring that the treaty signed between the Savai Madhavrao first, the Peshwa, of course Nana Fadanvis has done everything on his behalf, but nominally Savai Madhavrao Peshwa and British. So the treaty that is signed between these two, Mahadaji Shinde was made responsible to ensure that both the parties are following the treaty, and he is also made responsible that he should punish the party which is not following. So we see here Chhatrapati's Chhatrapati Sardar is Peshwa. You know, Peshwa, one of the courtier, one of the important person in the court of Chhatrapati. And Peshwa Sardar now Shinde, he is now ensuring that the agreement signed between Peshwa and British is to be followed. So militarily, he is becoming superior because he is being held responsible to punish the aggressor between Peshwa on the one side and the British on the one side. In the Maratha Confederation, there used to be a lot of conflict. Caste factor was an important factor. The Marathas and Brahmins, they did have certain caste conflict. Peshwas were Brahmin, and it is believed that later on, as Shinde and Holkar, Shinde were Maratha and Holkar were Dhangar, and Bhosle of Nagpur were Maratha, as they were not ready to take order from Peshwe. Peshwe has brought forward his own Brahmin Sardar, like Raste and Phadke, and that internal conflict it continued. Within the Brahmins also, there were a number of sections like Deshastha, Kokanastha, Saraswat, and this continued. So that of course remained one of the important weakness of the Maratha Confederation. But in spite of all this weakness and all this drawback and all this shifting power center from Chhatrapati to Peshwa and then Peshwa to Shinde Holkar again, what has kept this confederation together for a very long period? See, the conquest of North, it was generally started by Bajirao first in 1740, and the Maratha Empire became extinct in 1818. So it is almost a period of 60 to 70 years that the Marathas, they remain a very prominent military power in India. And it is not possible until unless there is some cohesive band, there is something which keep these people together. Unfortunately, that bond has not proved very strong. And finally, we have these Britishers defeating the Marathas by separating them from each other. But nevertheless, what kept this Maratha Confederation together, at least for the period of 60, 70 years, that is a feeling of being a Maratha. We have studied this, the inspiration behind the rise of the Marathas in the third semester. So, you know, the language, Marathi language, and the work of the Sant and the work of Shivaji, this has created a kind of bond where all the people of Maharashtra, irrespective of the caste and creed, started taking pride in being a Maratha. So that pride and the feeling of being a Maratha, like we can call it as a kind of medieval Maratha nationalism. As I told you in the last lecture, that the nationalism is a concept which undergoes over a period of time. Now, for us, the nationalism is like an Indian nationalism, but during those period, that was a very ill-defined concept. Though periodically we do get reference to we all are Indian, this kind of thing, and attempt to unite against the foreigner like Ahmad Shah Abdali. But nevertheless, the more prominent feeling was the regional nationalism, and that is Maratha nationalism. So we find that the feeling of Maratha nationalism had kept this confederation together. Respect for the House of Chhatrapati Shivaji, that has brought these people together. And that is the reason, even though Shahu was not a very capable military leader, people did not generally revolt against him, and they respected him. And same thing happened with Peshwa also. We know the Peshwa, Sawai Madhora, he became Peshwa at the age of 40 days only. A small child of 40 days was made Peshwa. But in spite of that, it is out of the respect for Peshwa's house, because he was a descendant of Bajirao and Balaji Bajirao and Sawai Madhavrao's house. So he was respected. So that respect for the house of Chhatrapati Shivaji and respect for the house of Peshwa, that has also kept the Maratha Confederation together for a considerable period. Of course, there is a self-interest. When the Maratha Empire was rising, people definitely joined with the winning party, and they thought that it is better that we should stick together so that we can fight against our enemies, that is Mughals and Rajput and Ahmad Shah Abdali and Pathan. So self-interest. But as the Marathas now were pushed on the back foot during the Second Anglo-Maratha War, we find that internal differences resurfacing, and the Britishers, much more clever, much more diplomatically advanced, were not the people who are going to lose the opportunity of creating dissension. And that is how they managed to separate Bhosle, that is how they managed to separate Holkar later on during the Second Anglo-Maratha War, and then how they managed to defeat Shindes and Bhosle, and later on Holkar. So, you know, this self-interest was, of course, one of the cohesive factor, one of the factors that kept the Maratha Confederation together. Next thing that kept the Maratha Confederation together is certain control of the central authority, though it was not very firmly established, but the Peshwas had the right to appoint the auditor for this for the Sardar that he brought forward. So Peshwas used to send his people to check the accounts of Shindes and Holkar and Pawar. Of course, it was never settled properly because those accountants themselves were paid bribe by this Sardar, and account was finally settled. Lot of money used to remain in area, like in the third Anglo-Maratha War, we have seen that large number of money was in arrear with the Gaikwad to be paid to Peshwa, and it was that Gangadhar Shastri was sent to settle the account, who was finally murdered. So there was a certain kind of loose control, and that generally depend on personality. See, if there is no written constitution, lot of things depends on personality. So long Madhava Peshwa was holding the power, he was, though young, but he was very strict, and everybody was afraid of his anger. So he managed to sometimes diplomatically, sometimes using a very coercive language, he managed to keep the account to certain extent in control. Bhausa Peshwa has tried to do it during the time of Nana Saheb Peshwa, and that in fact Bhausa Peshwa's strictness became one of the reason that he was not liked by many Maratha Sardar, because he was very strict in maintaining the account. But nevertheless, the system of maintaining the account was also one of the important reason that kept this Maratha Confederation together. And there used to be sharing of revenue. For example, Shinde's area, he has to keep certain portion himself, and certain portion he has to keep to Peshwa, certain portion he has to give to Chhatrapati. So all that system of sharing of revenue also kept this Maratha Confederation together. Then over a period of time, this nature of Maratha Confederation also undergone changes. During Rajaram's period, it was mostly the Marathas who fought against the invading Mughal army. But as now Marathas, they expanded towards north, and as now they came in contact with the European people later on, they started recruiting the non-Maharashtrian people on a larger scale. Like Shinde's army, the Maratha nature has undergone considerable changes. His army was mostly commanded by the French general, who had trained battalions under him, and Shinde also recruited large number of people from northern India. In the Maratha Confederation, we find there were people working Arab platoons were working, Gardis were working, Gardis were Pathan, and there were people from northern India as well. So the Confederation army initially, which was having a prominently Maratha character, had also undergone a lot of change over a period of time. And these Gardis and Arab, they did not had a lot of feeling of the Maratha nationalism. They were mercenaries. They serve only for money. And in history of Marathas, there are a lot of incidences of these Gardis and Arab creating a lot of trouble for the payment. In fact, the person who murdered Narayan Rao Peshwa was a Gardi. He was from North India, brought to Pune for serving. And there was one Gardi who even tried to murder Bhausa Peshwa before Panipat. And then, as the central authority in this Maratha Confederation weakened over a period of time, especially after the death of Madhavrao Peshwe, the British they took advantage of this weakening of the central authority, and finally they intervened, and finally it led to the downfall of the Confederation. So this is what I have to speak about Confederation. It was not a very big topic. Well, is there anything else that you want to ask me, or this is? Is this clear to you? Well, okay.